Miscellaneous Writings. Book 4. Part 4 of 9, of The Life and Times of David. By Charles Henry McIntosh. Better known as CHM. Recording by Irving Riz using Digital Voices. Part 4. Nabal and Abigail. 1 Samuel 25. It is interesting to observe, as we pass from stage to stage of David's history, how different individuals were affected toward his person, and the consequent position assumed in reference to him. It required energy of faith to discern, in the despised outcast, the future king of Israel. In this chapter we are presented with two striking examples of persons thus variously affected in reference to David's person and career. There was a man in Maon, whose possessions were in Carmel, and the man was very great, and he had 3,000 sheep, and 1,000 goats, and he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal. This Nabal was an Israelite, and he appears in marked contrast with David, who, though anointed king of Israel, had not where to lay his head, but was a wanderer from mountain to mountain, and from cave to cave. Nabal was a selfish man, with no sympathy for David. If he had blessings, he had them for himself. If he was great, he had no idea of sharing his greatness with anyone else, and least of all with David and his companions. And David heard in the wilderness that Nabal did shear his sheep. And David sent out 10 young men, and David said to the young men, "Get you up to Carmel, and go to Nabal, and greet him in my name," etc. David was in the wilderness. This was his place. Nabal was surrounded by all the comforts of life. The former owed all his sorrows and privations to what he was, the latter owed all his possessions and enjoyments to what he was. Now, we generally find that where advantages are derived from religious distinction and profession, much selfishness exists. The profession of truth, if not connected with self-denial, will be connected with positive self-indulgence, and hence we may observe at the present day a determined spirit of worldliness connected with the very highest profession of truth. This is a grievous evil. The apostle was made to feel the anguish of it, even in his time. "Many," says he, "walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things." Phil 3:18-19. Observe, they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. They do not throw off any semblance of Christianity, far from it. Many walk. This expression shows a measure of profession. The persons here pictured would, doubtless, be much offended were any to refuse them the appellation of Christians, but then they do not want to take up the cross. They desire not practical identification with the crucified Christ. Whatever amount of professed Christianity can be had apart from all self-denial is welcome to them, but not one jot beyond this. Their God is their belly, and they mind earthly things. Ah, how many must plead guilty to the charge of minding earthly things? It is easy to make a profession of the religion of Christ, while Christ himself is unknown, and the cross of Christ is hated. It is easy to take up the name of Jesus into the lips, and walk in self-indulgence and love of the world, which the human heart knows so well how to estimate. All this finds its full illustration in the person of the churlish Nabal, who, having shut himself up in the midst of his luxuries and wealth, cared not for God's anointed, nor felt for him in the season of his painful exile and sojourn in the wilderness. What was his reply to David's touching appeal? "Who is David? And who is the son of Jesse? There be many servants nowadays that break away every man from his master. Shall I then take my bread, and my water, and my flesh that I have killed for my shearers, and give it to men whom I know not whence they be?" Here was the secret of this worldly man's estrangement of heart. He did not know him. Had he known him, it would have been a very different matter, but he neither knew who he was nor whence he was. He did not know that he was railing on the Lord's anointed, and casting from him, in his selfish folly, the privilege of ministering to the need of the future king of Israel. The moral of all this is deeply instructive. It demands the clear vision of faith to enable anyone to discern the true glory of Christ, and cleave to him in the time of his rejection. It is one thing to be a Christian, as people say, and another thing to confess Christ before men. Indeed, One can hardly find anything more selfish than that condition of heart which would lead us to take all that Jesus has to give, and yield him nothing in return. Provided I am saved, all the rest is unessential. This is the secret thought of many a heart, and if thrown into a more honest form would be this: if I am sure of salvation, it matters little about the glory of Christ. This was just Nabal's mode of acting. He reaped all the advantage he could from David, but the moment David put in his claim for sympathy and aid, his worldly spirit developed itself. One of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, saying, "Behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to salute our master, and he railed on them. But the men were very good to us, and we were not hurt, neither missed we anything, as long as we were conversant with them when we were in the fields. They were a wall to us both by night and by day, all the while we were with them keeping the sheep." This was all very well. Nabal could well understand the value of David's protection, though he cared not for David's person. So long as David's men were a wall to his possessions, he would tolerate them, but when they would become a burden, they were rejected and railed upon. Now, as might be expected, Nabal's acting was directly contrary to Scripture, as his spirit was decidedly contrary to the spirit of its divine author. It is written in the 15th chapter of Deuteronomy, "If there be among you a poor man of one of thy brethren, within any of thy gates, in the land which the Lord thy God gives thee, thou shalt not harden thy heart, nor shut thy hand from thy poor brother, but thou shalt open thy hand wide to him, and shalt surely lend him sufficient for his need, in that which he wants. Beware that there be not a thought in thy wicked heart, saying, 'The seventh year, the year of release, is at hand, and thine eye be evil against thy poor brother, and thou givest him nought, and he cry to the Lord against thee, and it be sin to thee.'" Precious grace! How like God! How unlike Nabal! Grace would keep the heart wide open to every object of need, whereas selfishness would close it against every applicant. Nabal ought to have obeyed the word, independently of his knowledge of David, but his selfishness was too deep a character to allow of his obedience to the Lord's word, or his love to the Lord's anointed. However, Nabal's selfishness led to very important results. It led, in David's case, to the exhibition of much that was calculated to humble him in the presence of God. He is here seen to come down from the high elevation which usually characterized him, through the grace of God. No doubt, it was deeply trying to meet with such base ingratitude from one to whom he had been a wall of defense. It was galling, too, to be reproached on the very ground of those circumstances in which faithfulness had called him, to be accused of breaking away from his master at the very time that he was being hunted as a partridge through the mountains. All this was hard to bear, and, in the first ebullition of feeling, David gives expression to words which would not bear the examination of the sanctuary. "Gird ye on every man his sword," was not just the language which we should have expected from one who had hitherto walked in such a meek and gentle spirit. The scripture just quoted presents the resource of the poor brother, viz., to cry to the Lord, not to draw his sword for revenge. Nabal's selfishness could never have been remedied by the sword of David, nor would faith ever have adopted such a course. We do not find David acting thus in reference to Saul. He left him entirely to God, and even when induced to cut off the skirt of his robe, his heart smote him. Why did he not act thus toward Nabal? Because he was not in communion, he was off his guard, and the enemy took advantage of him. Nature will ever lead us to vindicate ourselves, and resent every injury. The heart will secretly murmur, "He had no right to treat me thus, I really cannot bear it, nor do I think I ought to do so." This may be so, but the man of faith at once rises above all such things. He sees God in everything. The jealousy of Saul, the folly of Nabal, all is looked at as coming from the hand of God, and met in the secret of his holy presence. The instrument is nothing to faith, God is in all. This gives real power to move on through all sorts of circumstances. If we do not trace God in everything, we shall be constantly ensnared. We shall have occasion, as we proceed with our subject, to trace this principle more fully, and shall now turn to another character introduced to our notice in this instructive chapter. This is Abigail, the wife of Nabal, a woman of good understanding, and of a beautiful countenance. A noble testimony, surely, and one which shows that grace can manifest itself in the most untoward circumstances. The house of the churlishnable must have been a withering scene to one like Abigail, but she waited on God, and, as we shall see, was not disappointed. The case of this remarkable woman is full of encouragement and instruction to all who may find themselves cramped and hindered by unavoidable connections and associations. To all such, the history of Abigail simply says, be patient, wait on God, do not suppose yourself void of all opportunity for testimony. The Lord may be much glorified by meek subjection, and will, assuredly, give relief and victory in the end. True, some may have to reproach themselves for having formed such connections, or entered into such associations, but even so, if the folly and evil are really felt, confessed, and judged before God, and the soul brought into an attitude of thorough subduedness, the end will be blessing and peace. In Abigail we see one who was actually used to correct no less a personage than David himself. It may be that her course, up to the time at which the sacred historian introduces her to our notice, had been marked by much that was painful and trying. Indeed, it could hardly have been otherwise, associated with such an one as Nabal. Time, however, brought to light the grace that was in her. She had suffered in obscurity, and was now about to be raised to an unusually high elevation. Few had seen her patient service and testimony, but many beheld her exaltation. The burden which she had borne in secret was about to drop off before many witnesses. The preciousness of Abigail's service did not consist in her having saved Nabal from the sword of David, but in keeping David from drawing the sword at all. Now David had said, surely in vain have I kept all that this fellow has in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that pertained to him, and he has requited me evil for good. This was terrible. And David was rashly taking himself out of the place of dependence, the only happy, the only holy place. Nor was it on behalf of the congregation of the Lord. No, it was to avenge himself on one who had treated him badly. Sad mistake. Happy was it for him that there was an Abigail in the house of Nabal who was about to be used of God to keep him from answering a fool according to his folly. This was just what the enemy desired. Nabal's selfishness was used by Satan to ensnare David, and Abigail was the Lord's instrument to deliver him. It is well when the man of God can detect Satan's working. To be able so to do, he must be much in the presence of God, for there alone can he find light and spiritual power to enable him to cope with such a foe. When out of communion, the soul becomes distracted by looking at secondary causes and subordinate agents, just as David was distracted by looking at Nabal. Had he paused to view the matter calmly before God, we should not have had such words as, in vain have I kept all that this fellow has in the wilderness. He would have passed on, and left this fellow to himself. Faith imparts real dignity to the character, and superiority over the petty circumstances of this transient scene. Those who know themselves as pilgrims and strangers, will remember that the sorrows as well as the joys of this life are evanescent, and they will not be inordinately affected by either the one or the other. Passing away is written on everything. The man of faith must, therefore, look upwards and onward. Now Abigail, by the grace of God, delivered David from the unhappy influence of the present, by leading his soul onward into the future. We learn this from her exquisite address to him. And when Abigail saw David, she hasted, and lighted off the ass, and fell before David on her face, and bowed herself to the ground, and fell at his feet, and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me let this iniquity be, and let thine handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thine audience, and hear the words of thine handmaid. Let not my Lord, I pray thee, regard this man of Belial, even Nabal, for as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I thine handmaid saw not the young men of my Lord, whom thou didst send. Now, therefore, my Lord, as the Lord lives, and as thy soul lives, seeing the Lord has withholden thee from coming to shed blood, and from avenging thyself with thine own hand, now let thine enemies and they that seek evil to my Lord, be as Nabal. For the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fights the battles of the Lord, and evil has not been found in thee all thy days. Yet a man is risen to pursue thee, and to seek thy soul, but the soul of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of life with the Lord thy God, and the souls of thine enemies, them shall he sling out, as out of the middle of a sling. And it shall come to pass, when the Lord shall have done to my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning thee, and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel, that this shall be not grief to thee, nor offence of heart to my Lord, either that thou hast shed blood causeless, or that my Lord has avenged himself. But when the Lord shall have dealt well with my Lord, then remember thine handmaid. We can hardly conceive anything more touching than this address. Every point in it was calculated to touch the heart. She presents to him the evil of seeking to avenge himself, the weakness and folly of the object of his revenge. She reminds him of his proper occupation, viz., fighting the Lord's battles. This must have brought home to his heart the humiliating circumstances in which Abigail met him, even rushing on to fight his own battle. However, perceive that the leading point in this address is the special reference to the future. The Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house. The soul of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of life with the Lord thy God. When the Lord shall have done to my Lord, etc., and shall have appointed thee ruler over Israel. All these allusions to David's future blessing and glory were eminently calculated to withdraw his heart from his present grievance. The sure house, the bundle of life, and the kingdom, were far better than nobles' flocks and herds, and in the view of these glories, David could well afford to leave him to his portion, and his portion to him. To the heir of a kingdom, a few sheep could have but little attraction, and one who knew that he had the anointing oil of the Lord upon his head might easily bear to be called a runaway servant. All these things Abigail knew as matters of faith. She knew David, and knew his high destinies. By faith she recognized in the despised outcast the future king of Israel. Nabal knew not David. He was a man of the world, swallowed up with present things. With him there was nothing more important, nothing more influential, than my bread, my flesh, my shearers. It was all self. There was no room for David or his claims. This might be expected from such an one, but surely it was not for David to go down from his elevation to grapple with a poor worldling about his perishable possessions. Ah, no. The kingdom should have filled his eye, and engaged his thoughts, and lifted his spirit above all lower influences. Look at the master himself, as he stood at the bar of a poor worm, the creation of his own hand. How did he conduct himself? Did he call upon his little band of followers to gird on every man his sword? Did he say of the man who dared to sit as his judge, "In vain have I imparted to this fellow all he is, and all he has"? No, he looked above and beyond Pilate, Herod, the chief priests, and scribes. He could say, "The cup which my Father has given me, shall I not drink it?" This kept his spirit tranquil, while, at the same time, he could look forward into the future, and say, "Hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power, and coming in the clouds of heaven." Here was real power over present things. The millennial kingdom, with all its untold joys, with all its heights and depths of glory, glistened in the distance with everlasting light and brilliancy, and the eye of the man of sorrows rested upon it, in that dark hour when the scoffs and sneers, the taunts and reproaches of guilty sinners were falling upon his blessed person. Dear Christian reader, this is our model. Thus ought we to meet the trials and difficulties, the reproach, obloquy, and desertion of this present time. We should view all in the light of hereafter. Our light affliction, says an eminent sufferer, which is but for a moment, works for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Again, but the God of all grace, who has called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. O fools, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken! Ought not Christ to have suffered these things, and to enter into his glory? Yes, suffering must come first and glory afterwards, and anyone who, by his own hand, would seek to take off the edge of present suffering and reproach, proves that the kingdom is not filling the vision of his soul, that now is more influential with him than hereafter. How we ought to bless our God for having opened to us such a vista of glory in the ages to come! How it enables us to tread, with a buoyant step, our rugged path through the wilderness! How it lifts us above the things which engross the children of this world! We're not of the world, which fades away. We're not of the night, but children of day. The chains that once bound us by Jesus are riven. We're strangers on earth, and our home is in heaven. May we prove the sacred reality of this more, as we pass along through this vale of tears. Truly the heart would sink and the spirit faint, were we not sustained by hope, even the hope of glory, which, thank God, makes not ashamed, for the spirit is the earnest of it in our hearts. In pursuing the narrative of David and Abigail a little further, we have a still more striking example of the vast difference between the child of nature and the child of faith. Abigail returned from her interview with David, and found Nabal very drunken, wherefore she told him nothing, less or more, until the morning light. But it came to pass in the morning, when the wine was gone out of Nabal, and his wife had told him these things, that his heart died within him, and he became as a stone. And it came to pass, about 10 days after, that the Lord smote Nabal, that he died. What a sad picture of a man of the world! Sunk in intoxication during the night, and when the morning dawned, struck with terror, pierced by the arrow of death. How solemnly like the multitudes whom the enemy has succeeded, in every age, in alluring and intoxicating with the perishing joys of a world which lies under the curse of God, and awaits the fire of his judgment. They that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night, but, ah! The morning is at hand, when the wine, apt symbol of this world's joy, shall have altogether evaporated. The feverish excitement in which Satan now involves the spirits of the men of this world shall have calmed down, and then comes the stern reality of an eternity of misery, unspeakable misery, in company with Satan and his angels. Nabal did not even meet David face to face, yet the very thought of his avenging sword filled his soul with deadly fear. How much more terrible will it be to meet the gaze of a despised and rejected Jesus? Then the Abigails and the Nabals will find their respective places, those who had known and loved the true David, and those who had not. God, in his mercy, grant that my reader may be amongst the happy number of the former. I would only observe, further, that the interesting narrative of this chapter gives us a striking picture of the church and the world, as a whole, the one united to the King, and associated with him in his glory, the other plunged in irretrievable ruin. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting to the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwells righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot, and blameless. 2 Peter 3:11-14. Such are the soul-stirring, momentous facts presented to us throughout the book of God, in order to detach our hearts from present things, and bind them in genuine affection to those objects and prospects which stand connected with the person of the Son of God. Nor will aught else, save the deep and positive conviction of the reality of these things, produce such effects. We know the intoxicating power of this world's schemes and operations. We know how the human heart is borne away, as upon the surface of a rapid current, when such things are presented, schemes of improvement, commercial operations, political movements, aye, and popular religious movements too. All these things produce upon the human mind an effect similar to that produced by Nabal's wine, so that it is almost useless to announce the stern facts presented in the above solemn quotation. Still, they must be announced, must be reiterated, and so much the more, as we see the day approaching. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. All these things shall be dissolved. The heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also, and the works that are therein, shall be burned up. Such is the prospect presented to all who, like Nabal, surcharged with surfeiting, and drunkenness, and cares of this life, have rejected the claims and appeals of Jesus. The world is being prepared, with inconceivable rapidity, for the introduction of that one who, by the energy of Satan, will head up all its institutions, embody all its principles, concentrate all its energies. Let but the last elect one be gathered out, the last member be incorporated into the body of Christ by the quickening energy of the Holy Ghost, the last stone be set in its appointed places in the temple of God, And then shall the salt be removed, which now preserves the world from corruption. The barrier presented by the presence of the Holy Ghost in the church shall be taken out of the way, and then comes forth the lawless one on the stage of this world, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power, and signs, and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Surely these things ought to check the career of the men of this world, and lead them, with solemnized minds, to consider their latter end. The long-suffering of our Lord is salvation. Precious word. Most precious. But let it not be abused, let it not be mistaken for slackness. The Lord waits to be gracious to sinners, not to connive at sin. However, as has been already observed, it is almost useless to speak to men about the future who are wholly engrossed with the present. Blessed be God, there are some who have ears to hear the testimony about the kindness and grace of Jesus, as well as about his coming judgment. Thus it was with Abigail: she believed the truth about David, and acted accordingly, and all who believe the truth about Jesus will be found separating themselves diligently from this present world.